Hey everyone, welcome to the Coaching Dominance Show, where I, Ankit Ahuja, your host, brings you the insider knowledge and behind the scenes of the top coaches, trainers, and consultants. I publish interviews of them so that I can show exactly what they are doing to succeed. I will also share straight to the hard points, tips, so that you can get your clients and more structure in your business, and you will be able to sell more. You'll be able to sell your services, build your audience, connect and communicate with them and more. So ladies and gentlemen, continuing the tradition of bringing top class trainers and coaches on the show, today we have the king of confidence, Bishal Sarkar, on the show. Now, hailing from a small city called Siliguri, Bishal Sarkar was once an introvert person and now he is an authority on public speaking. And he's one of the highest paid public speakers in India. He is the author of the book, I Love Public Speaking, and he helps people speak with confidence. And if any one of you wants to become excellent in public speaking and in presentation skills, then he's the go-to guy. And let me tell you, Bishal is one of the most energetic person I have ever seen. His students and clients brag about him because of the results and transformation they have seen him bring on the table. So Bishal, welcome on the show.
Awesome, man. This is amazing. Happy to be on the Coaching Dominance. Ankit, glad to be here with you.
Amazing, amazing. So let me ask you this, Bishal. Being an introvert to being known as the king of confidence and an authority in public speaking, what was the journey like so far?
Man, I'll tell you, thank you for the great question. Oftentimes, not just me, anybody, any good speaker you look at, oftentimes they think he must be born as a great speaker. Nobody's born as a great speaker. Everybody's born a baby. Everybody's born a baby. Everybody comes out naked, afraid, scared, and hungry. So for my journey, not trying to, go too much deep into the story, but the thing is, I was born and brought up, like you said, in a small town called Siliguri. And I went to a school called Siliguri Boys High School. It's a government school, Bengali medium. Bangla is my first language. So my school tuition, just to set the context, was 289 rupees per year. And in those government schools, you don't have AC, you have fans with bent blades, you have A plus B, A plus B is not a formula, it's two initials of two people's names, they are written down, a lot of things in the benches, the smelly toilets and all, that's where I come from. And I always had a passion for cricket growing up. I felt that one day for sure people will see me on TV playing cricket. That didn't go out very well because of different situations. So that's where I came from. And I was actually bullied, Ankit, for 4 years by a school teacher. He used to physically bully me. He used to make me kneel down for hours and hours. He used to call me names. And, those 4 years, I remember every single day, there was when I used to come from school to home, every single day I used to think, when will this end? Because I don't know about you, but I had no courage to tell it to my parents because I knew if I told anything bad about my teacher to my parents, they would scold me more. So I had nobody to tell it to. The friends in the school were making fun of me. The teacher was bullying me. The parents, I couldn't tell anything. And I became like this person inside this shell, this invisible shell that I created. Like a cocoon, exactly. The cocoon who couldn't fly because I was not a butterfly. So I was the cocoon and it was painful to be the cocoon for many, many years. And then when I started working for, First Source Business Standard, I mean, at that time I didn't know, but I couldn't open up to people. Even though people came to me, I was talking to them because that past conditioning, it's like the memory of the pain. There's an old thing I was reading just a couple of days ago that, a man five times, if you make him walk on glass, he will not feel comfortable walking after that at all because the memory of the pain is attached in his mind that walking means pain. In the same thing for me, that people meant pain for me. People meant pain for me. So that's low self-image, low self-esteem, low self-confidence. It hampered any personal relationship. I was very afraid of actually approaching anybody that I liked, any girl that I liked. And that was, my career was at a toss, my self-image. I was living like a dead life. So that's where I came from. And then over a period of time, I made an effort for sure. I took the traditional route, like reading books, going to courses, this, that, but until and unless I really went all in and I found a mentor who really believed in me and showed me the ins and outs, not just giving me information, but showed me the real path for transformation. That changed for me. And I don't say this to brag, but I don't feel I have reached anywhere. I feel I'm in the journey. And now our work for the last 12, 13 years of training people, you know, especially my people that I coach are, you know, managers, leaders, vice presidents, CEOs, those kind of people. Training them on how to be confident speakers is like, you know, easy for me, because right now we don't teach them just confidence. We teach them how to rock every presentation, especially Ankit, in today's time. If you see, this is not just speaking on stage. It's you got to be good on video calls. I know everybody thinks, oh, just because I have a Zoom account, I know how to speak very well. It's kind of like saying, just because I have a gym membership, I'm very fit. No, you have to learn the skill, your body language, your facial expressions, how you make a connection with the people, all that things when we do, and the results, more than my results, when I see the results of, for example, the vice president, the managing director of Indian Public School, Dr. Shiv Kumar, it melts my heart. And it reminds me, you know, that's the whole full circle here, that it reminds me why I was bullied. I was bullied so these people don't have to. I was bullied so I could be the messenger for them. I'm not the hero. I'm the guide for these heroes, these managers and leaders. So that's the story about how I came. And
amazing. Amazing. You know, thank you for being candid and sharing that. And in, you know, how in Gita we say, jo hota hai bhale ke liye hota hai. Like, that's what I see the journey. Like, everybody has their highs and low. And when I see their journey, they always remind themselves about those highs and low. And then talk to people saying, look, that was the lows which I had seen, and that's the reason I am what I am. So thank you for sharing that. So how come from that being a speaker, what's that professional journey like?
In the beginning, I did not want to be a speaker. Professionally, I just wanted to be a speaker for myself. I wanted to break that shell, that cocoon. I had no desire to create a butterfly park. I just wanted to be a butterfly on my own from the cocoon, right? I just wanted to get out of the shell. When I did, and I started making the progress, you know, I love that line that Tony Robbins says, there is one thing that makes a man happy, progress. When I started making progress toward my own speaking, people started noticing that around me, that, okay, there is something. I don't know what he's doing, but he's doing something. I don't know who he is, but he's a somebody. I don't know what he is up to, but he's up to something. So people started approaching me. This is the energy part. It's, you know, one thing I know you teach amazingly, you know, sales to coaches and consultants. I'm sure you agree with me that it's not just the techniques, it's your energy, the messenger. People can sense through that, right? That the energy and the confidence that you carry along with you. My father always said Bruce Lee did not have to open his shirt to show that he was a martial artist. You know, the way he walked and his stance and his look, people figured it out. He's a somebody. So when I started making progress, even though I was not a somebody, but I was being a better version of me, people started noticing that. They started coming to me saying, hey, you know, you speak well. How did you learn? Where did you go? How can I learn? So I started giving them advice for, you know, freely. Like,
so what were you doing at that time?
I was working for a company called Business Standard at that time.
Okay. Okay.
So yeah, the journey started. Yeah, but people started coming to me when I was actually working for Business Standard.
Okay.
And then people started coming and saying, okay, you know, can you teach me how to do that? Because one skill that I developed very well is my spontaneous speaking ability. That does not mean that, give me any topic, I'll speak. Because in the real world, that's not how it works. In the real world, life is not scripted. No matter, you know, in sales, no matter how great you create, light goes off. Mic doesn't work. Somebody says something and there is a loud noise, a baby crying. What do you do? How do you make fun? Not make fun. How do you have fun in those situations? So, for example, a quick little tangent on the other side. Once I was doing an event there in Royal Orchid Hotel in Bangalore for public speaking course. In the middle of the presentation, entire light went off in the hotel for about a minute. But think about it, like 25 people in the workshop, light complete off. And I said, okay, we have females in the room. Don't touch anybody. Everybody started laughing. Right in that moment. And that is the moment that showed everybody that, okay, he knows how to handle situations. Anyways, back to the story. When I was working for Business Standard, there were many situations, even if somebody's pen fell or the book fell, something like that, I would always make a comment that would make people crack up. And that's when people started noticing me. And whether you're a manager, a leader, or a coach, or a consultant, that's the thing. People are noticing you not when you are ready to speak, but when things go off and when things are not right and how you handle that situation. People judge you in darkness more than when you are actually on stage.
Absolutely.
Right. So I started doing that and people started noticing. And then, you know, one by one, I started hearing that very often, and the frequency increased, the level of caliber of people. Even my boss's boss at the time, and one day came and said, you speak pretty well, you know, can you give me some advice? I was like, is he joking? And then I saw some other people, and my confidence, you know, started boosting a lot inside. And I started giving him advice. And then later on, I found out, you know, I remember this line by, you know, Larry Winget. I don't know if you know the guy, very, very successful speaker. He said, find your uniqueness and exploit it in the service of others. Find your uniqueness and exploit it in the service of others. So I found that, okay, if people are coming over and over about something, it means something there. So I went out and I started seeing from the outside. And that's when I realized that that's my uniqueness, you know, speaking powerfully, spontaneously. And then I started teaching that skill to other people. And that's the journey.
Tell me more about that transition, Vishal, where you found out, okay, saying that, okay, this is my USP and I can do something about it. From that time to actually started doing something on that.
So when I found that out, I started so this is a story about my first one-on-one coaching client. So I started posting on social media at that time, you know, I'll coach, and some guy called me.
Which year was it we are talking about?
2007, 8. Oh. 7 or 8.
So many
years.
One
guy called me out of two, and he said, I want coaching. And I had no clue, like, you know, everybody can relate here. Had no clue how much to charge is that. I said, $1,500. I swear, $1,500. He said, per session. I said, now 10 sessions. So...
मार्केट खराब होता है,
मार्केट खराब नहीं हुआ है, मार्केट एक्चुअली इंप्रूव हुआ है, बिकॉज़ दैट्स व्हाई आई स्टार्टेड. एवरीबॉडी हैज़ टू स्टार्ट समवेयर. आई हैड नो
रेफरेंस,
आई हैड जीरो रेफरेंस पॉइंट, एंड आई आफ्टर आई क्लोज दैट क्लाइंट, आई गॉट कॉन्फिडेंस. सो द नेक्स्ट क्लाइंट समबडी सेड, आई सेड 5,000, नेक्स्ट टाइम 10,000. आई वाज नॉट ग्रीडी, बट व्हाट हैपेंड इज आई स्टार्टेड अंडरस्टैंडिंग माय ओन वैल्यू एट दैट टाइम, राइट?
या
सो see, in the beginning, you can do anything you want. In beggars cannot be choosers. You have to start somewhere. And that's where I do it. And then, you know, the prices started increasing and this, that. So to start with, that's when I started. Then I started doing workshops as well. In the beginning, I used to take 10, 15 people in a room. We rent out some very cheap place, Koramangala Club. I had a friend who is actually a member. I said, please get me a room there in a small hall. I can pay less. And we got all this, and I was doing, man, I was bang on passionate from day one about transformation. Money did matter to me. It does matter. Money gives options. But I was more about the transformation of the people, not the transaction. I think, you know, I suck at sales. I'm not a good salesperson at all. I don't know how to connect with people. And that's how things work out for me. And I have a lot to learn from you about sales. But the thing is, at that time, because of the transformation, what started happening is, you know, I started getting referrals and repeat customers. So people came to me for one program and they got so much value. They said, okay, if I can get so much value in your 2-day program, 3-day program, how does a 1-year mentorship with you look like? And that started happening for me. So one by one, you know, my mentor always says this analogy of a small ball of ice. You know, it's like the snowball effect. You throw it down the hill, it comes down, and the more it comes down, it gets momentum. The more momentum it gets, the bigger it becomes, because it is accumulating more ice. It's becoming bigger and better, and that's how things are happening right now. So amazing. That's how amazing. I got started. $1,500, you know, for 10 sessions, one-on-one, 1 hour every single time. But I think a common mistake, if I can just quickly talk about that, that many coaches and consultants make today, is they start copying another speaker's business model. It's very, very common these days. Okay, he's making a membership site. I have to make a membership site. His program is called So-and-So Blueprint. I'll make it So-and-So Blueprint. He's doing 8 weeks. I'll do 8 weeks. He's doing webinar 90 minutes. I'll do webinar 90 minutes. It's like one, it's like, you know, imagine if I take a small paper and if I, you know, take a Xerox copy of, you know, something like that. If I take a Xerox copy of this, and then a Xerox copy of that Xerox copy, and then a Xerox copy of that Xerox copy, very soon it's going to be just a blank page, because it's losing value. So that's why you have to find out your business model. And that's why it's not about just when it comes to business, for especially coaches and consultants, because I know those are the people that you serve the most. It's not about you blindly copying anybody. It's about understanding the context, what you like, what your target market wants, and then providing that for people. And that will be a game changer for people.
Amazing. Amazing. So, you know, very well, you said about the Xerox copy page. I mean, that example will remain with me forever. And I have seen that happening. Now, if you really see in the market, you know, there is what's happening is like MLM, what is happening. People are business model, and that is to sell the business model. And the next person creates that business model to sell the business model. And what people are not selling, what people are not selling is the real value. What people are actually selling is just the business model of, you know, how to make money by training and coaching. And that's what many people are actually falling the trap into. And what you said makes sense, saying that find your own journey, find your own path. But what do you think people should do at that time, at this stage? Let's say, you know, when you were starting up and you had no idea, you had no clue, you just figured out something and you went ahead. A lot of the listeners are actually in struggling phase where they don't know what to do. I mean, I can recall my own journey back in 2015. And, you know, just before our interview, I was telling you how we spoke in 2016, we got in a call. At that time, you know, I was struggling. I didn't know what to do. Now I have things figured out. Now I have a, you know, good base now to talk about. But at that time, I didn't know anything what to do. I had just shifted from Africa. I was very new in India. I had no clue about how to start, what to do. What is the tips or what kind of guidance you can give to those kind of people?
First, stop teaching. If somebody's starting out, they should not just go for a course and start teaching the content from the course. That's what many people do. So you have to look back at your past five years of your life. I know, see, many times people, you and I both see it on Facebook or Instagram or stuff like that. No experience required. Become a transformational coach in one day. How is it? It is like no cricket experience required. Become a cricket coach. The problem we have, Ankit, right now is we have too many good marketers and very few good mentors, right? So Tony Robbins has a line. He says that people often are very good at marketing their mentorship than they're actually at the mentorship. So they talk big things, you know, we are building this in, and everybody these days has, I'm on a mission to help 10,000 dash and dash, right? 10,000 this, 10,000 that. It's like copying somebody's business model. And I understand that. Where it's coming from. But the thing is, you have to find your uniqueness. So ask yourself maybe, you know, questions like, so two exercises I can easily say is, number one, make a list of what things you're already good at, right? Again, you know, the concept of ikigai, what you're good at, what the world needs, what you can be paid for, what is fun for you. You have to find that. Otherwise, it's like blindly chasing just a career or a niche. And the niche, the micro niche, these words are very popular these days. But you have to find what actually speaks to you. That's number one. Number two, text some of your best friends, very close friends who are not afraid to be blunt with you and say, okay, what makes me special? What do you think is my talent? And be willing to listen. Don't direct them. Don't say this or this. No close. No optional close there. Just keep it open. You know, let them say. And they might say, give you an answer that you are not expecting at all. And that's okay. Stay with that. And then make a list. It's going to take a little time. You will not find those answers on a YouTube video or in a membership site by a business coach. You have, this is the self-reflection you have to do. And then ask yourself, am I really willing to do that for the next 10 years of my life? One story that inspires me a lot is by Pele, the player. The first time when his coach came and said, you are going to play for your championship, for a championship, and we'll pay you. Pele was like, I will play my favorite game. And they will pay me for that. What a wonderful life, right? Most people are not good at the game. They just want to get paid for an average game. So that's why, even though you see their income report and all that, they'll say, okay, I made 5 lakhs in 30 days or 9 lakhs in 90 days. They vanish after the 90 days because it's like a hike and then they're going down. There is no consistency. That's why people need the foundation. So to answer your question, what can somebody do to find their uniqueness? Text your five best friends, closest friends who are willing to be blunt with you, and text them, hey, what makes me special? I'm doing a little research. What do you think makes me special? What do you like about me? You know, not as an individual, what are my skills that I have? And you will see pattern. If five people are out of the five, four people are mentioning that one skill, something there to think about. Yeah. And then you ask yourself if you can monetize that skill and then add value to people. I know you do that. I've been doing 1900 videos on YouTube for the last few years right now. I've been sending a daily email. I send an email every single morning, 9:45 a.m. and 2 p.m. every single day for the last 5 years. Right. So this is like a consistency is where it's at. It's It's like the spiral, the same thing that I was talking about, the ball. And you do it. There is no get rich quick. It's get rich for sure scheme that I'm interested in.
True. You know, in such a short span of time, you have said so many things, so many value adds. We actually have to pick in, declutter this for the people who are listening, because so much content you're adding, so much things you're adding, Vishal, here. So now you rightly said about this thing, you know, a lot of people are actually saying, I mean, if you see one of the highest selling courses in India is Find Your Right Niche. And people are confused. And the reason people are confused is because they are not moving ahead. And, you know, this has happened with me also. I mean, I'm telling you the truth. A few years back, you know, I wanted to start something. And I know that, okay, I'm good in sales. I've worked 13 plus years in companies like Microsoft, Cisco and all that. But still, because I have not started yet, I'm sitting in my corner and I'm thinking, okay, what else? What else? What else? And because it's not starting, because of, you know, I was not pushing myself ahead, I was actually thinking about multiple things and people get confused there. Now, once you find your niche, you need to go ahead on that. Any thoughts on that, Vishal? For example, you know, okay, let's take this example. For example, a few years back when I was into sales and I was doing sales training, now I want to start something and I know that, okay, my niche is sales. For somebody in that stage now, what they should do?
Be more specific. I'm still not sure.
Okay. So my question to you is, let's say somebody finds their niche. Whatever their niche is.
They have found their niche.
Okay. Then what they should do? Or what should they not? They should not do.
You have found your niche. You have found, you know, who you want to help specifically. Yes. First thing, I'm going to give you three tips. First thing, have the balls to say no to everybody else.
The right target market.
Yeah, that's what people fuck up. So they know where I'm going. And then somebody comes and says, okay, can you coach me? They say, yeah, I'll do it. I'll do it here also. You become
people
a generalist.
People are desperate at that time. You know, they don't want to say no to anyone. They're scared of saying no.
If you are desperate when you are at 100, you'll be desperate at a million. Desperation is a mindset. It's a skill. From day one, I had high standard for me. Even though the $1,500, I over-delivered to that guy. I charged $1,500 not because I was desperate, because I did not know what to charge. I had no clue. I did not ever charge for speaking words before that. How would I supposed to know? If somebody comes and says, how much will you charge for playing badminton? You have no reference point.
Like, of course.
Give me the badminton bat. Right? So first of all is have the guts to say no to everybody else. That's the first thing, it has to be there. So standard that this is what I'm going for. I have to say no to everybody else. It's like marriage. True. When you get married, you don't say, you know, yes to another woman, right? Because you're committed to that niche, that micro niche here.
Get married, get committed to that micro niche.
That micro niche, absolutely.
And that target customer. Okay.
If you want to change, then make it official, divorce, and then go move forward instead of having 3-4 different women in your life. If that makes
sense. Yeah. True. Well said. That's a good example. Yes.
Second is be, I know it's a cheesy line, but I'm going to explain, be the authority in that niche. So meaning you have to find their pain points. You have to find and speak to that. There are six things. We can talk about the empathy chart later on. I can just draw it out for people here. So yeah, there are six things. Is it okay, Ankit, if I just add a little bit value or detail? Okay.
Yeah, let me pin your video also so that it can be visible.
Right. So this is what I call the empathy exercise. In that field, so what most people start doing is, once they find a niche that, okay, I'm going to help business owners, the startup CEOs or whatever the thing is, you know, that niche, they think that, okay, I have to just chase them. Chasing is bad. You know that. Don't chase, choose. How do you do that? Very simple. I'm going to just quickly write it down. It's called the empathy exercise. This very small little structure. I'm just writing it. I'm going to show you in just a minute. There are six things you have to get clear on. This is the messaging part, not the social media yet. Most people, what they start doing is they come on social media and they start blabbing. It's almost like your body is not made yet in the gym and you start opening your t-shirt. Well, not yet. You will show, you will demonstrate, but after you get the messaging right inside. So this is what I call the thin feel. So these are the six things you have to get clarity on. Okay. So think and feel. What are they thinking and feeling generally? What are they hearing constantly? What messages are they getting in that niche? What are they seeing? Maybe they're seeing ads, they're seeing Sadhguru videos. What are they seeing visually? Yeah. What are they seeing? What are they saying and doing? Maybe they say, I want this, they do something else. And the final part, what is their pain and gain? So this is the chart, right? If this things is super clear about them, because now these six things is what you talk about. So for example, I'll give an example. So I train only managers or leaders. If somebody comes and says, okay, I'm just starting out in my career, I have the money to join your program, can I? My team member will say, no, it's, you know, appreciate you reaching out. You're not ready for this yet. So we, first of all, we have the discipline to say no to everybody else apart from the you know, people.
And
that we,
you know, I agree to that because I remember when we got on a call, you told no to me in 2016.
Leading the example. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for sharing, by the way. So then for managers and leaders, what are they thinking and feeling? First of all, they're thinking in the mind. I'm going to give just quick examples for my niche so it's much more clear to people.
Sure.
So I'm thinking, okay, you know, I'm successful, but I also feel stuck in my career, in my life, because not at the level people, how people see me. What are they hearing? They listen to some, you know, good song. They don't listen to just typical Bollywood music. They listen to some classical song. I know. What are they seeing? They're bombarded with ads. What are they saying? They say, they talk a lot about leadership and management and bouncing back and crisis and turbulent times. But what are they doing? They are stuck. They feel. So I talk about these things in my content. And then pain and gain. What's their pain? I make a list. What do they want to be? I talk. These are the things I talk about instead of talking about. Look at me. I am the public speaking evangelist. I am on a mission. This, that, video. No, I'm talking about those six things on a consistent basis because that makes people feel that I get them. One of the brilliant lines I heard from Joe Polish, ilovemarketing.com, he said, connection happens when, not when people understand you, but connection happens when people feel understood by you. Wow.
Amazing.
So they, I mean, I often get email replies to my daily mentor newsletter goes on, are you reading my mind? One sentence reply. Right? Because I am, because I know these people for last so many years. I know exactly what they go through. I know their daily routine. I can speak one small thing and they know this guy gets me. So as a coach, as a consultant, those of you who are listening right now, I'm talking to you. Think about in your niche, what do you know about them? You know, get to know people. And that's why I'm a big fan in the beginning of anybody's career, Ankit. Do not start a group coaching program. Don't start a membership site. Get on a call, first of all. Get to know them. First 10, 15 people, spend some time on the phone call to really hear the feedback that what are they going through in their words. Yeah, in their words. Nobody wakes up in the morning, if you're choosing a health niche, nobody wakes up in the morning saying, optimal health optimization, I want that. No. So what do they want? What's their thing? So the messaging can be, if you're choosing a health niche, do you ever wake up in the morning, you take shower and you come in front of the mirror and you don't like yourself and you don't tell anybody. So you blah, 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 blah. So now they think, oh my God, he's reading my mind. How does he know it? So when you articulate somebody's problem better than they can articulate themselves, they automatically give you authority to fix it for them. So these are just a few tips on, you know, how to find a niche and how to really become an authority in that. And of course, after that, you can go all in, you can do like you teach your clients, you know, doing podcasts, videos, writing book. There are many different tactics. Yeah. But tactics work and tactics fail. If I take a gas balloon, imagine a red hot gas balloon, it will fly up. But if I take a normal balloon and put hot air in it, it will not go up. It will go down. So on the outside, I might think that balloon went up. This balloon did not. Not because of the balloon, but what is inside the balloon. So it's not the speaker. What is inside the speaker? The messaging. It is hot air. That is helium. So I call it the marketing helium, my friend Doug Gordon calls it. You need the right messaging and that's when things explode. Does that add value?
Amazing. Amazing. Thank you, Vishal. You know, it creates such a nice picture for people to understand, to give it a structure to how do you actually judge your target market? How do you actually think beyond yourself and actually go and think about other people? Because everywhere this messaging is coming, saying that, you know, keep adding value, think about others, add value. But to give actually a structure of it, that's what you have done. So amazing, amazing. And you know what people, when they're starting up, people are not very sure about themselves. They lack that confidence within themselves. And that shows. So let's say if I wanted to become a sales trainer and if I went ahead and I spoke to a corporate and I'm not confident, they don't trust me because I am very tentative. And a lot of this happens with even with established trainers and coaches. They are okay in their own world, But when it comes to actually speaking from the stage, when it comes to actually being in front of their clients, they stumble, they are tentative, and things doesn't work out. So what's the secret behind that confidence? And I'm asking the king of confidence here. So yeah, over to you.
Well, it's a skill. It's a process. There is no one thing I can say right now, but I'm happy to give tips. But I'm saying it's kind of like, you know, how do you become great, powerfully healthy, or how do you run very well? There is not one thing. There are multiple things. That's why it's a process. And I'm not asking, okay, oh, see, he's a speaker. He teaches confidence. No, I don't care if you come to me. In fact, coaches and consultants, it's best. Ankit is the best person to coach you on that. But for now, few tips I can give you about your confidence level is, you know, you have to really believe in the value that you bring in. Real value. I'm talking about real belief, not a fake belief. I know many people say fake it till you make it. I say, why fake it if you really value in that? Ankit, quick question. In the room that you're in, where is the switchboard?
This side.
You did not have to look. You don't have to, oh, where is it, right? You already know. When you know, you're freaking confident, right? When you know, you're freaking, it's right here. How much is it? 2.5 lakhs, right? Simple, because you know the value. There is no, it is this, but so that's a practice, first of all. You know, you have to normalize the thing. I don't get up in the morning when I tie up my shoelaces, if I want to go somewhere, I don't get excited about it. It's normal. So normalize your feeling. You get a great deal, don't post on social media, woohoo, got a corporate deal. No, it's normal. Make it normal. When you normalize your feeling, when you stay calm down, when you really are confident, it's a game changer. I'll tell you a little story about my arrogance. So 2014, at that time, my phone number was on my website, my own phone number. So a lady called, and she called, she said, my name is Snigdha Poonam. I'm calling from Times of India. We want to interview you. I said, what took you so long to interview me? First line. Arrogance, right? You can call it arrogance, but because I was ready. You don't get ready, you stay ready. I gave a demo interview to Times of India in my mind years before they ever came to me. I was ready. So when they came to me, it was normal. Times of India. So I got a huge page coverage with my photo on that. I didn't pay anything. They interviewed me for that show. 2014, right? At that time. I was ready. So visualization is very important. You know, visualize in your mind. Sit down, get your points ready, and expect questions. People, when there is a money transaction, people will actually ask you questions. They will give you objection. How do you do that? Do you become aggressive at that time and start speaking fast? Or do you calm down? You say, okay, yeah. Your price is too high. What do you mean? Having a smile. What do you mean? Right? It shows the man, he's not bothered, because at that time, people see it's not your message, it's the messenger. And it's a process. That's one. Second is your daily routine. Your ritual is very, very important. It's very hard to be a great athlete for 90 minutes in a game. If the rest 20 hours, 22 hours and 30 minutes, you're fucking up your routine, right? So it's what you're doing outside the field determines what you do inside the field. So your routine, your practices, these are things you have to learn from a mentor who teaches you the tips, techniques, the mindset, the habits, the strategies. And that's why it's a process. I'm sure if you're a coach and consultant, you know, you take your clients through a process. They can't expect result in just 1 second. So go through the process, your ritual, your routine, spending time learning something every single day, and doing verbal practice. I mean verbal practice, not just thinking, reading. I call it the, you know, success porn, which is, you know, watching a lot of videos from this membership site, this audio, books, and feeling like I'm doing something. No, you're not doing something. You're watching other people who are doing something. That's the difference between porn and sex. You know, it's you're watching somebody else doing it versus you doing it. There is no productivity there, if that makes sense. It's a strong example right there, but I think it gets into the mind of the people.
Nobody will forget it.
Nobody will forget.
True.
That's what you need to do. So on a daily basis, and it's a game. It's like a muscle you have to develop. I don't have much here, but I have much here and here, right? So you have to develop a lot of muscle and speak. And then one thing that I do, to really get real confidence, a small little hack is I did in the earlier years. If you have at least one or two testimonials, it's not for others. Before a meeting, you see that. You read that. You read those good comments. I have an entire folder in my email box of all the people emailing me saying, thanking me after my programs, this, that. So I read that. I flood myself, my heart with positivity, before I go for a speech or a meeting, because now I'm full. I'm reminded of the past success. Many people say oftentimes, "What I have anxiety. I have this nervousness." Ankit, anxiety is nothing but a prediction of a future failure. It's a prediction of a future failure. You're predicting that and you're living that failure in your mind before it even happens. So instead that, if you just look at your past successes and you get juice from that, nutrition and nourishment from that, it gives you that power and the strength to move forward for the next piece, the next presentation, the next phone call. Does that make sense?
Let me share a personal example here, Vishal. A few years back, probably 2 years back, I was very new in coaching, and there was a group coaching session happening where like 20, 25 high HNIs were sitting there in a room, and I was doing my coaching session, and I had a one-to-one client also in that team. And that guy stood up and he complained against me in front of everybody. He said, "Okay, you know what, Ankit, he's not a very good coach. I feel he's lacks this and this and this and this, and I want a new coach." And, you know, it shattered me because I was zapped. And this happened to me like very first time when a coaching client complained against me, where I was thinking that everything is going fine and he was not happy. And I was not aware of it. And that happened with me. And that actually spiraled up and I went into my own zone for at least a month, where I was thinking so much, what's wrong, what's wrong, what's wrong. And all the thing which I'm thinking is, what's wrong with me? So everything which I'm thinking and noticing is, okay, something is wrong with me. And that brought me in a bad spiral. And one day I was thinking, what's happening? You know, I had a group coaching session online like this on a webinar, and I couldn't do it. I had to tell one of my friend to continue, saying that, you know, I can't do this. Can you continue? And I came out of the room and I was thinking, what's happening? What's happening? What's happening? And then I came back, and you know what I did? I removed a file which was from my training program a few years back. And I opened that file and I saw all the participants had given a feedback to me about in that file. And everything which they wrote, I read about me. And it was like a testimony over testimony over testimony. I had like 100 pages of that. I read through it. And I saw the overall rank which I had got was like 9 stars out of 10 as an average. And the next day when I entered in the room and I did that webinar session, everyone was zapped. And they were saying, what happened? What went into you? So exactly what you told me, I can completely relate to that.
Absolutely. That's very valuable. And because, you know, oftentimes what happens is, as a, even if you're a manager or a leader, one small incident, our focus goes just there. One small negative incident, you know, it all, the focus goes there. It's a little about my target market. I know that are the people that I coach and train, you know, vice presidents, CEOs, oftentimes they're so busy doing so many things. These are overachievers. You know, they're like super achievers. If something negative their wife says, you know, they come home, imagine a CEO after working a lot in the office pre-COVID, they come home and the wife says, "You don't love me." That one comment right now, it's in their mind the entire day, the next morning, it ruins up the entire thing. So that's when the value of, you know, you bouncing back, not physically, but internally comes back. And instead of, and then it becomes like, you know, "You don't love me." And you're like, what do you mean I don't love you? I gave you this last week. Well, just because you gave me this last week, does it mean you love me? And then there is this entire parroting and, you know, fighting. So when the wife says, "You don't love me," all the husband needs to say is, "What do you mean?" And now she's going to open up more and say exactly what she means, right? And now the CEO has a better chance of connecting and meeting her needs. Oftentimes, we don't give people the need that they need. We start providing what I want, right? So meeting those needs is very important. And you meet your need by looking at the appreciation from previous clients, previous customers, hundreds of them. And we have like so many different testimonials from managers, leaders. And oftentimes, even sometimes, you know, the other day, a guy emailed me saying, "You are an arrogant prick. Who do you think you are?" And for a few seconds, you know, my shoulder became a little hard. I could feel that while reading that email. And then I realized, man, he must be going through a tough time. This is not me but trying to be Gautam Buddha, but I really felt he must be going through a tough time. And it's okay. And I just, you know, emailed him back saying, "Hey, good luck. Thank you so much for your feedback. We'll think about it." And boom. And then email me back saying, hey, sorry, I was having a bad day, blah, blah, blah. So oftentimes it happens. So there is, I like what Gary Vee says. If somebody says something positive, I don't listen to it. If somebody says something negative, I don't listen to it. I'm good either way. Right? So I don't, my chest doesn't become very big when somebody says, you are the greatest. I don't have a spit in the stomach when somebody says, you are an asshole. I'm fine either way. And that's a place to go to. And that's a journey for me. That's a journey for you. That's a journey for all of us. That if we can reach there, that's called coaching.
How to reach there?
Practice, man. It's a daily practice. Practice by practice. I don't mean practice speaking, practice techniques. It's next time. One thing I can say is somebody says something nasty or you look at a Facebook ad and you see other people being successful, just observe your breath. I'm a student of Vipassana meditation. So went there for 10 days, many years ago. And it's a game changing. It's observing breath. That's your routine, your ritual. Who you are off the stage is more important than who you are on the stage. That's a game changer. Ankit, if I can take just a quick second on a different tangent here.
Yeah.
Right now, a lot of coaches, like you said, they're copying this, that, without having any substantial, skill. I know you have been working as a business coach for the last couple of years after you came from South Africa. You have now, so that gives you credibility. I was doing a session the other day in a small group call inside our program, the Rock Your Speaking Leadership Circle. And we had like 25 people in that group. And there is a lady, her name is Suma. She's a professor in a college for the last 20, 25 years. So I said, Suma, can somebody become a great professor in a 3-day digital course? And she said, no, not possible. I said, exactly. Because somebody has to go through the process to see the progress. So you need depth, not just width, not just visibility, but the right credible depth of things. I was talking to the other person, Joy, the other day, and I was telling him, if you don't have content, if you can't speak on a topic for 7 days straight, don't open your mouth about that topic. You're not credible in that area yet. That doesn't mean you'll never be, but not yet.
Not yet.
So not yet. So that means, that's why the real experience, knowledge, and practical how-to techniques. I can say one thing, Ankit. You put me on any stage. I might not be the best speaker there, but people will talk about me because of my passion. I don't fucking care if the light goes off, if the mic goes off. I'm going to shout. I'm going to be there for the people every single time because that's what my thing is. And so if you're a coach, if you're a consultant, if you are a trainer, a speaker, understand you are the walking, talking ad of your message. When you open your mouth, you tell the world who you are. Your confidence is the passport to your freedom. So work on you before you actually market and sell the dream to other people. And that's when people see you, they should be like, I don't know what that girl or that guy is, but he's a somebody. And I think that's a journey, Ankit, that if a coach or consultant takes, game changer. Game changer.
Amazing. Amazing. I feel like I can talk to you for hours because just watching you explaining everything with your body language, with your facial expressions, with your hands and everything, so much energy you carry, Vishal. I can feel myself that I'm in a more energetic state from the time I began. And, energy cannot be born. Energy cannot, you can only transfer energy. So where do you get so much energy, Vishal? I'm asking a very different question right now, but yes, where do you get so much energy? What do you do?
Absolutely. That's a great question. In fact, we have an entire section on that inside our program, but I'll tell you right now. So when people call energy, there are two ways. One is the typical, how do you have the health, vitality, energy, right? So drink water, sleep, intermittent fasting, run, jog, meditate, all that. I'll tell you, there is a secret energy drink that you can drink every single day. If you have it once, actually, you can get it on Amazon, by the way. Yeah, I'll give you an affiliate link, so I make money out of it. Energy drink that you can buy, and you don't have to drink every single day. It's one time. If you get it one time, and that energy drink is called Purpose. And you don't get it on Amazon. Purpose is the ultimate energy drink. When you are a man on purpose, man on a real mission, not to write on a social media, but real passion, real purpose. You know who you're helping, how you're helping, why you're helping. man, it's a game changer. So even if you're not a speaker, if you're a manager or a leader and you have a purpose that I have to be the best father that I can be, I want to be an example of a husband, I want to be an example for my team. And when you have that passion, that purpose, you will have downtime, but you will not have a down life. You will be old, but you'll always be bold. You will absolutely have time that are tough, but you're going to be tougher because your passion and purpose is going to give you a kick. It's not a temporary motivation. There is a difference between a spark, a flame, and a bonfire. You're going to be the bonfire, like the fire of energy. You don't need, you know, Red Bull. You don't need the coffee to charge you up. Even if you wake up and after that there is something, you're going to be so passionate and purposeful about what you're doing because you're going somewhere. We all need a place to go. Somewhere I'm going, I'm reaching there. The problem that most people have, Ankit, in today's world, especially men, women too for sure many times, they don't have a North Star, something to look at where I'm going. So it's like, I don't have a North Star, but I'm blind. So I'm just taking random steps here and there. And in between, I'm looking at this other person. Okay, he's doing that. So I have to do that. He is doing that. Okay, but where am I going? I don't know. But versus somebody who might not be that fast, but he has a vision, the North Star. Even if I deviate a bit, because there is a hole there, there is some challenges there, but I'm constantly looking there, so I'll eventually go there, right? That's the North Star. The question I have for you, no matter what you do, is what is your North Star? What is the thing that lights you up? Because once you find that North Star, the light from that is going to give you the energy. Purpose is the ultimate.
You know, Vishal, just a week back, I created a new journal for myself because, you know, the goals were changing and things were happening. So I created a new goal for myself. And I created like a journal book, which I wanted to give it out for printout so that every morning I can read it through. And the name of the journal is Ankit's North Star.
Whoa!
Good. Can you believe it? Amazing. What's your purpose, Bishar? What's your mission?
See, I just got goosebumps when you asked the question right now. I have a big purpose, and this is not the number. Number is not important, but I want to help people. I want to help men become men again, real men. I'm not talking about the gender here. I'm talking about, you know, men don't have balls between the legs. They have balls here and here, right? So my mission is to help managers and leaders become true men and become the alpha males so that they can live the life of confidence, power, and influence for the rest of their lives. That's what I'm doing right now. But my eventual goal, my eventual passion, my eventual purpose is actually to feed dogs. Honestly, I feed 22 street dogs on a daily basis right now. My mission is to create, this is not a business for me, the dog thing. You know, this is something I do out of my heart. I am very passionate. There was a time in my life, Ankit, I used to actually, out of fear, throw rocks at dogs. I was so bad as a human being. Out of fear, you know, out of fun, some children do that. And now when I see dogs, I meet the eyes, you know, I look at them in the street every single day, no matter whether it's raining, it's shining, it's rainbow, I'm happy, I'm sad, feeding dogs every single day. I feel that if I can inspire people to do two things, is number one, become the best confident version of themselves and feed enough dogs, the world is going to be amazing. And that's my passion right now.
Wow. Amazing. Amazing. Amazing, Vishal. You're a great person, Vishal. And you know, I was just reading a book and in that, the author was saying that if you're not doing anything which is helping or inspiring others on daily basis, then you're actually dying every day. You are not living every day.
Right.
So amazing. I see that you're doing that. So Vishal, you teach people on confidence. You teach people on presentation skills, on speaking skills, how to speak from stage, how to be confident. I know you are full of energy. You show people how to be like that energetic. And as you mentioned, you are helping the CEOs, the corporates, the VPs and, you know, those kind of people to be actually the alpha male of the people. Do you also help trainers, coaches in any way?
Few times, yes. We do have some healers and coaches inside our program, but they are not my primary area because, you know, they have a lot of help. Yeah. I mean, they have people, amazing, great coaches and mentors like you. I feel, so the answer to the question, yeah, some coaches, if they want to really become powerful speakers, yes. I don't teach them business skills. I don't teach them marketing sales. In fact, I'm not good at sales and marketing at all, as you know. But what I really help people do is the manager, I'm mentoring the people that don't have mentors, men. If you look at India right now, I mean, a lot of coaches right now, they're targeting the youth, right? 18 to 25, the Gary Vee style, you know, they're teaching them, they're showing that, look at my yacht, look at my income stream, look at my thing, micro this, micro video. So those people are taken care of. People who are not taken care of are 35 to 50 corporate males, corporate people there. So they have this boring corporate training in the office that they have no respect for the trainers there. But they don't know how to share. Like a 35, 36 year old man, he has so much pain inside the heart. That's why he sometimes, it's not the confidence is not just the main issue for them. For them, it's like, how do I make an impactful, influential communication? And how do I improve my reputation? You can't do all that if you're holding so much of pain inside your heart. It's like the, you know, the, so you have this, you know, that sabotaging thing that's holding you back constantly. So that's what I do. I don't just teach them techniques. Techniques anybody can find online, you know, body language, smile, have the hand like this. That's not the thing. That's like the wrapper, the balloon, red balloon. I teach them the gas inside, the right air inside. I'm going to teach you, show you a quick thing here, not teach. But the other day I was having fun with my team member about this. That I saw an ad. I'm not going to show the name to protect them from the embarrassment. The problem is, let me hide the name here. So somebody, he says, I don't know the authenticity of that. I'm sure he is right. He's a Tony Robbins trained team member. So he actually opened for Tony Robbins. You can imagine, high level speaker. He now teaches $1 million speaking. Okay, million. Not rupee, dollar speaking. Their class, $1 million speaker master, $50.
Oh God.
How is that congruent? $50. You're so great at sales that you're providing $1 million, not the Ford, $1 million speaker for $50. I took a screenshot and I put it inside our team group. Everybody's laughing. And that's the problem that we have right now, that many people are giving a message. They are not living the message. They are not living the message. But I think that when the coach and consultant really lives the message, it's going to be amazing. That's what we need. We don't need another coach who's basically saying nothing. We don't need another like that.
Amazing. Amazing. So Vishal, for people who are actually, who want to get connected with you, who want to learn from you, what should they do?
This is the time that every host, your show guest wants, is waiting for, right? This is the time they're going to say, follow me here on Facebook. Go to this link, actually. In fact, go to this lead magnet, download my PDF so I can get your email. This is like the golden moment.
Absolutely.
Ankit, do all of that. I really mean that. I really mean, if you are a follower of Ankit, please don't follow me. And here is why. Don't follow me, meaning if you go deep with Ankit, there is no point you following me on social media. I don't want you to be a subscriber. I don't want you. Best thing you can do for me and Ankit today is go take fucking action on what we spoke about. Don't let this be another success form. Be the success nourishment for you. Don't let this. So no website, no follow, no Facebook link, no lead magnet, none of that bullshit. You don't need to follow me. Follow Ankit. Follow your dreams, follow your mentor Ankit here, and just go deep with him and learn from him, enroll in his program, call him and say, hey, how can you work with me? Go deep instead of just following. That would make me more happy than you being a follower. That's what I want for people.
Kudos to you, Vishal. You know, you are actually living with what you're saying. You know, you're actually doing walk the talk. And what you said, there is already in how much time? You must have spent like 45 minutes now, and in that much time, so much value has already been given. So many things which already been speaking, which actually people can implement right now. And what you're saying that, okay, don't just keep following everyone. Don't just keep downloading things. Don't just keep changing your mentors and things like that. Just take action, because you already know what action you need to take. If you don't know what action to take, that's a different thing. But if you're watching this, already so much has already been discussed. And yeah, just take action. So Vishal, you yourself are a trainer and a coach. You mentor so many people. What's your ups and downs, what you have seen?
I have a brother who has mental retardation. I have gone through a terrible breakup 10 years ago. Since then, I'm in a very amazing relationship now for the last 11 years. I found my soulmate. I have had suicidal thoughts. I have gone through depression. I have my friends cheated me many times with money. So without trying into soft stories, everybody has challenges. And this, everybody has challenges. I mean, that sometimes people think, okay, yeah, his speaker, his freak. I have to make sacrifices for my brother. I have to make sacrifices for this and that. But you know, the real thing at the end of the day, that's the down. I'll tell you the up. The real up for me is at the end of the day, after doing the work, after living my life, after feeding dogs and all that, when I go to the terrace, every single day I go to the terrace before going to sleep. I fucking love Vishal Chakkar. I love that bastard. That's my up. I'm getting goosebumps while saying this. But so no matter what happens, my eventual goal is saying yes. Do you know the guy, Brendan Burchard? Do you know him, of him? So he has these three questions that I ask myself, these three questions. Did I love? Did I live? Did I love? Did I matter? So in the at night, if I say, did I live? And if I said yes, it's a pretty good day. Did I love? Yes, it's a pretty good day. Did I matter today to other people? And if the answer is yes, it's a pretty good day. So the reason I'm saying this is find your two or three questions, dear listener, that you're going to ask yourself at the end of the day. So no matter what down you have, that's like your daily North Star. That's how you evaluate yourself on a daily basis. So that's my ups and downs. You know, I have time where I feel very happy. At times, you know, there are challenges just like all of us. My cousin brother, it's not a negative thing, but, you know, a sad thing that, couple of months ago, he committed suicide. He was one of my closest person in my family. So that was a loss, but doesn't matter. What I mean by doesn't matter is, you know, I was very sad for a few days, but I had to bounce back because I have to be the example for other people. It's not me. It's not having the mask of happiness. It's having the blood of happiness. So ups and downs everybody has, but I think my spiritual depth of Bhagavad Gita that I refer to on an almost daily basis right now, I'm not able to do on a daily basis. And just looking at what people need from me on a daily basis and just seeing messages, that melts my heart and that changes me. So those are my ups and downs.
Wow. Thank you for sharing that, Vishal. You know, you, as I said, you have no filter. You know, you are so candid. Thank you so much for being candid and sharing all the thoughts with the viewers here. So, as you mentioned about, you know, these kind of daily rituals, the three questions which you ask, really powerful. In fact, while you were saying that, I was actually recalling that did I actually did that? And I think, you know, I will actually implement that in my own life. Really powerful. Amazing. Amazing.
And you mentioned did I live? Did I love? Did I matter?
Yeah. Amazing. Amazing. I think I'll just note it down and I will make sure to follow that. And you also mentioned that you read Bhagavad Gita almost on a daily basis. So what's your day like? What's your secret of performance?
Oh, so this, I don't wake up early. That's my first secret. So I'm not a 5 a.m. club member. I am a wake up whenever I want club member. because I'm all in for waking up early. It's not just my cup of tea, you know.
Of course.
I believe, because of what I've seen, is it is not the hour that you wake up. It's actually what you do with the first hour after you wake up. So after I wake up, I have a, you know, journal method. I know exactly what I'm doing there. But after waking up, the first thing I do is, you know, the typical things. I write down my goals quickly. I read a quick sloka from Bhagavad Gita sometimes. And then I'm an audio learner. So I take some, if I'm listening to a podcast or some of my mentors, I'm listening to some audio programs to fill my mind. These are not motivational kind of thing, like very educational thing that I do. And every single week, one thing I do is I watch a good movie at least once a week. So, you know, a good, powerful movie. So one movie that I recommend everybody to watch, actually something that most people have not heard of, even though it's a great one, is this. The movie was based on this book. The movie is called, this is my favorite book in the world, The Way of the Peaceful Warrior. The Way of the Peaceful Warrior, right? So, Ankit, if you think about it, most alpha males, whether they're coaches, consultants, or managers or leaders, they have the warrior part, right? They don't have the peaceful part, right? They don't have this part, peaceful part dialed in. So it's a fiction. It's not a non-fiction. It's a story about a guy who was very great in athletics, He was a great athlete. And then he meets a mentor who used to work in a petrol pump, who taught him the value of life, how to think rightly. And then he won the Olympics. Actually, it's a real story by a guy called Dan Millman. So this is my favorite book. And so I watch one movie every single week, not the typical, Jagdi India, 3 Idiots type movie, even though these are amazing movies, but find something that gives you a long-term inspiration, not a short-term motivation. So that's something I do. And the energy, the ritual that I do have is on almost multiple times a week, we have group calls inside our program members. So I have the Rock Your Speaking Leader Circle. We have the Balance Like Mastermind, which is a higher end program. So when I speak to them and I hear about their result and they come up with questions, that gives me energy, and that's how I do it. I go out with my life partner. We go to different places. We have some roadside chai. Now we are not having roadside chai.
It's a very different time now. We both
love nature. We both love, we both feed dogs. We talk to people. We feed people also. I know some people will say, dog only you feed, people you don't feed. You have no idea in that case. Let's not go there about the people. I'm just saying people also. And I think at the end of the day, confidence is nothing but an expression of the love that you already have. Your communication is the expression of what is inside. If you take a orange and if you squash it, orange will come out. If you take tomato, squash it, tomato will come out. If you have love and you speak, only love will come out. And people can sense that. People can feel that he has no filter, or he's saying exactly what he means or what she means. And that's what my mission is, to make you that powerful, influential speaker.
Amazing, amazing. I feel like I want to join your inner circle and actually become like that.
Visa, so MasterCard, or American Express.
I'll share with you. Vishal, how are you coping up with the current situation?
Yeah, that's a very good question. And I'll tell you a very powerful answer, which is not my line. So my mentor Jason once told me, never be a rugby player, always be a chess master. The difference between these two people is rugby player is always busy. Like, I have to do something now. Chess player is, he might lose a few places. The last step is what matters, right? So the final game is what matters. So right now, to give a thing, I know a lot of people are talking about bouncing back and, make everything virtual, which is amazing. I've been doing virtual training since 2014, a part of hybrid, live event and virtual, including 2014, before Zoom came into picture. Back then we had Skype those days. So right now, the business part, we are supporting clients more than ever before. They have full access. More than anything else, it's reminding people of who they are. I'm staying in touch with people. We have different WhatsApp groups inside our mastermind clients. So just being there, it's just being the most confident version of ourselves. I know a lot of people talk about positivity, pivot, bounce back, those words, how to lead in uncertain times. Everybody's giving a speech on that. But for me, it's all about adding most value to our clients, existing clients. And there is an old saying by Warren Buffett, when everybody's afraid, be greedy. When everybody's greedy, be afraid. So right now, many people are afraid of losing money and greedy about getting short-term money. Do the opposite. So I have not, Ankit, done any kind of advertising in the last, actually ever since. All my things are organic relationship. Think about you. You said 2016, you called us. There was no ad. You probably went to Google, you typed something, you found my website. Is that right?
Yeah.
Maybe on YouTube. So there was no retargeting. There was no funnel. There was none of that thing. So for me, organic relationship is what matters. So I stay in touch with my clients, Kalpana, Dr. Shiv, Rajesh, Venkatesh, all the people, Palash inside our program. We have a guy called Shrikant from Amsterdam. So on all the people, we stay in touch. It's like a family. And that's what I do. So value add, staying in touch with people. And this too shall pass.
Amazing, amazing. So while, almost 1 hour is over and while we are coming to the end of the show, I want to check with you, Vishal, what's your next big goal? And of course, this is a challenging times. So how do you see overcoming that? And then what's your next thing?
What's interesting, something I'm very passionate about right now, something that I'm very excited about, is actually teaching people the speaking part, regardless of the medium, right? So regardless of the medium, because public speaking is not what you do on stage. It's actually how you are showing up on an interview. I mean, if you, dear listener, think about it. If you are at 1 hour mark right now, and if we both held your attention for 1 hour, there is something we both are doing right in speaking. Both of us are doing right. So that's what it's about, because right now attention span of people generally is going down and down and down. Quick statistic, Ankit. Attention span of goldfish. I'm telling you 2015 statistics right now. Okay. 2015, not even fresh. It's going to be much worse now. Goldfish attention span is 9 seconds. Human attention is eight seconds. Right. In 2015, before TikTok came into the picture, before all this crisis, so it should be 4 or 5 seconds. How do you hold people's attention on a video call? When somebody comes and people have their kids in the background, there is somebody crying, there is this fan not working, light not working, and you stay there on a call and you come on a call with clients, you come on a call with your corporate team member, how do you hold their attention? So we call it the triangle of speaking, right? So you have to be good. I call it, you have to rock the room, rock on Zoom, and rock the stage. You got to be master of three. Rock the room, meaning the boardroom, small audience, you know, four or five people, 10 people. How do you rock there? Then rock on Zoom, WebEx, doesn't matter, virtually, and rock the stage. If you can master all three, if you can become a powerful speaker in a small room and just work the room and own the room, if you can hold people's attention on a Zoom call for so much longer, and if you can rock the stage in front of a large audience, you're going to be fucking wealthy, not just money-wise, but attention, reputation, power-wise, wealthy. So that's what I'm excited about teaching people that we are teaching now inside Rock Your Speaking Program, is how do you become great at rocking the room, rocking on Zoom, and rocking the stage, so you become this powerful version of you.
Wow, amazing. Any tips for people who are actually daily on Zoom calls? Any quick tips for them? Squeezing more information out of you, Vishal.
Sure. No, so you said you are people who are on phone call. Can you give me some context?
People who are on doing virtual calls like Zoom.
Right. For what context?
Okay.
For what context?
Let me add the context here. So, you know, a lot of trainers who have been there in training or coaching, who were there more, let's say more comfortable doing trainings in the room. Let's say when we're talking about corporate trainers, they are actually incorporates training an audience of 10, 20 people, or even the coaches who are very comfortable talking one-to-one. Now, everybody has to go on online on virtual, and people are not used to the format. I mean, I'm not talking about the technical wise, but actually gaining that attention, because when you're in a room, you can see people, you know, who is attentive, who is not, who is zoning out, and then you can actually pull people in. But in Zoom, it's so difficult. So what, any tips for that?
Okay, yeah, sure. Few tips. Oh, got it. I got the context now. First of all, your first impression is your last impression. So on stage, real stage, like physical in-person stage, does not mean stage of a stadium, you know, even in a corporate room or whatever. You have 7 to 15 seconds to make a first impression. Virtually, 3 seconds.
3 seconds. Oh, amazing.
How do you do that? So most people, they just come in like, okay, yeah, I think, let me check if the mic is working. 1 second. Hello. Hello. Okay. I think you guys can hear me. And they go on like, So you have to get all these things right. Your body language matters. Most people speak like this. They are just their face and they're talking like this. No, your background, you know, your body language, your hand gestures, your facial expressions. Sometimes you're going to see, I say things like my voice modulation, I slow down. For example, a couple of minutes ago, if you remember, Ankit, I said, don't give the message if you don't live the message. See how I slow down.
Yeah.
Listen. So, and sometimes don't say there are three things involved here. Say, well, there are three things involved. Exactly. You got it. Three things involved here. First of all, right? So do this, you know, just small things, your facial expressions, your smiling and your shoulder is very important. Most people sit like this and they're like, they're listening like this. And then, yeah, I think now my time. No. Another final quick one or two tip is your first few seconds. Do not go into unpleasant pleasantries. Good morning, everybody. Happy to be here. Do something that gives them. So for example, if a video call started right now, for example, you know, I would do in a different manner. I would just come on and I would say, just give me a second. Let's say if this is the moment I'm starting a presentation.
One minute. I think we got
back
stuck. Yeah. Now you're on.
Most people are stuck. So that's a good demonstration. So imagine if I came on a video call right now on a count of 3, 2, 1, I would say something like this. Guys, the world is changing and the world is changing rapidly. How many of you agree with that? Just raise a hand quickly for me. Thank you. Awesome. All right. In the next 25 minutes, we are talking about exactly from the last week's report and I go into the content after that. But the first two sentences, it has to grab people's attention. It has to tell people that this is going to be an interesting, different kind of audience. And the final one, because you asked for this virtual presentation tip, a big mistake many people do when they join from their phone. So I have my mic, but I'm also using this. Imagine if they are on the phone, they're joining from the phone, right?
Keep it like down. Looking like
they keep it down. I'll tell you a very common mistake. You're right. There's a common mistake, which is when they're talking, they're looking at the screen. Yeah, right? I want, because they're looking at themselves. This is not where you look at. Even though that person is there, this is the eye connection point, right? The camera lens, the lens is where you look at, not the screen. So that's the mistake. You see sometimes when people make video, they're like, hey, this is Vishal Sarkar, and they're looking somewhere else. You don't feel that connection. Small thing, look at the camera, the lens, not at the screen. These are just a few tips that people can use right now.
Wow, amazing. Amazing, Vishal. Thank you so much. You know, I've squeezed sort of a lot of content there. I can actually go on and on and on, but you know, the time is passing here. And so yeah, you know, definitely a lot of things to learn from you. A lot of things people want to actually learn like that. I mean, if I might go further, I'll talk about myself itself. You know, I have done different experiments to myself to find out my way of confidence. I mean, from the age I remember, I was very like shy, mellow, soft kind of person. And I have been like that forever. But when I became actually a trainer, when I was on the stage, a lot of people who were mentoring me, and you know, I had a lot of mentors back then, not one. And some people used to tell me saying that, you know, be more energetic, show some energy. And I used to become like a radio jockey, you know, like I used to talk like that on the stage and try to, you know, mimic all that. But what was happening was I was not being myself. And people were reading through saying that, you know, why this guy is actually being fake. And that was reflecting me. And, you know, now I'm doing a podcast. I coach so many people. Confidence is not an issue. Like, I have confidence. But I have my own style of being energetic. But let me ask you, because, you know, you have trained so many people and you know what it happens. So being energetic versus being calm, what is your message on that?
If you want to be... this depends on the context and situation, but energetic and calm, they are almost synonymous. They are not opposite. Energy is calmness and calmness. Energy does not mean being loud. It does not mean shouting. It means shining and piercing through. I don't have to be shouting right now. You know, I don't have to shout to just talk about my energy. So quick thing about that is, if your presentation is 1 hour, do not drain your energy in the first 15 minutes. If you start with energy, remember to end with energy. So you have to maintain the energy throughout. I know a lot of people start a webinar or a call with a lot of energy, and 15 minutes down the line, they're like, anyways, guys, you know, their energy goes down. It sinks down. So you want to maintain your energy so that's why preparation is important. You have to know where you're going. A quick question I often ask my clients is, ask yourself, what do I want my audience to think, feel, and act differently after my presentation? What do I want them to think? What do I want them to, you know, feel, and how do I want them to act? So calmness and energy, they're almost synonymous to me. They are not opposite words. So you want to stay calm, at the same time energetic. For example, right now I'm calm. I'm not bubbling with energy like this, like a cartoon network, but at the same time, I'm calm, but I'm energetic. So if you give me an option, there is something, if you remember, you asked a question I did not understand. So I did not blabber. I said, I don't understand the question, because I have no problem doing that, because I really did not understand, right? So I stayed calm and then I understood the question. I said, yeah, got it now. Let me just tell you. So that authenticity is what people appreciate. So, you know, the mixture of energy and calmness is where the game is at.
Wow, amazing. So what you said makes so much sense, saying that energy and calmness is not two different things. It's actually a single thing, but how do you manage it? That should be your focus, rather than, you know, thinking, okay, I need to be more energetic or I need to be more calm. Don't focus on that. So amazing, Vishal. Now, while we're come to the end of the show, any parting words for the listeners who are watching here from your own point of view?
I have so many things, but I think the thing that will help your listeners right now the most is ask yourself, how do I want to be remembered at the end of my life? Not the at the end of the year, at the end of my year. You know, so-and-so guy, let's say his name is Satish, who's watching right now. Satish was amazing at copying from other people. Satish was amazing at making excuses. Satish was amazing. He was really good at lying. Satish was really good of taking other people's content and putting his name at the end of the quote. Or you want to say Satish was transparent. Satish was original. Satish was powerful. One of the best exercises I take my clients through in the mastermind is writing their final day statement. That how do you want, if newspaper covered you and your life, how do you want them to write about you after your death? I make them literally write that article in third person. Bharat is writing, you should write, Bharat was and blah, and that's your North Star. Now you know how you want the end life. So whether you are a coach or a consultant, I have so much respect for you. You are from my industry. You're from Ankit. We are in the same, we are colleagues, right? We are colleagues. So the message I have for you is be original, go deep. Don't just follow somebody's model just to copy that. It's not gonna, people will find out eventually and you're gonna look bad, right? You find your own uniqueness. You focus on your end client. What do they need? And provide it for them. And be the best version of yourself. And I think at the end of the day, coming back to the same thing, if you can go to the terrace, the mirror, the washroom, whatever, when you're alone, yeah, and if you just love yourself, nothing else matters at that time. Nothing else matters. If you can honestly put your hand in the heart and say, did I live? Yes. Did I love? Yes. Did I matter? Yes. Just go to sleep and you don't need sleeping pills at that time. You'll live a powerful, powerful life. Whether you're a manager, leader, a coach, consultant, an IT professional, a project manager, finance manager, HR, entrepreneur, doesn't matter. All the best to you. And always remember that public speaking is not about perfection. It's all about connection.
Wow. Thank you, Vishal. Thank you. You know, you stole my line, which I was supposed to say in the last, saying that, you know, my takeaway was those three questions, but as you already mentioned, now all that matters is, did you matter? Yeah. Thank you, Vishal. Thank you for coming on this show. You know, I hope you enjoyed, you know, I had a lovely time.
Loved it.
You know, I could have gone, you know, just on and on and on, because this topic of being confident from stage is something which I'm doing PhD for many years. When I say PhD means I'm researching on that, because I felt that's what was required for me. And I know for sure that's what requires for a lot of people. So guys, anyways, I'll leave a link of Vishal's website here down below, just in case you want to trouble him more. Thank you, Vishal. I'll see you again. And with that, everyone, bye-bye. I'll see you next week.
See ya.